want me to. Kingdom Builders Worldwide, where the pastor is Bishop Tino Smith.
Amen, amen, amen.
Pray that you'll keep him in your prayers while he's out of town.
Amen.
I'd like to give honor to my mother. She's my greatest supporter. Thank you so much. And to, I see two of my besties out here. Three of my besties, I mean. Liz, Karen, and Lynn.
Amen.
Appreciate you. Good to see you too. And Pastor Crawford.
Amen.
Amen. Well, there comes a time when we have to go through life with accusations hanging over our heads. And yes, it hurts when accusations are false. But I tell you, it hurts worse when the accusations are true. For a charge to be brought against you that you've done something wrong or said something out of line and that you stand in danger of being judged and condemned or said something inappropriate. I pray that in this time we consider the words of Scripture that we will have freedom from every accusation that has been raised against us, true or false. It's designed to keep you sidetracked. Please recognize that the enemy will do whatever he can to keep you distracted. For he knows if he can keep you sidetracked and out of the game, you will never, ever realize your purpose. There's a French phrase and it says, raison d'être. That means that's your reason for being. And we all was born with a reason for being. We all have a purpose in our life. And we have space and time to realize what that purpose is. An accuser is a person who claims that someone has committed an offense or done something wrong. Newsflash, I have lived long enough to know that accusations will come and accusations will go. What matters most is how you handle it. Life is too short to waste time with foolishness that's not going anywhere. Would you turn with me to the book of John, chapter 8, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 11 in the NIV version. This is a story that some of us may be familiar with, the story of a woman caught in the act of adultery. Incidentally, the man caught in adultery was not mentioned. This tells us that sometimes men protect their own species. Nonetheless, the woman was caught and brought before Jesus, accused of having committed adultery. And I will use this text as a basis for this message entitled, Go and Sin No More. Look at your neighbor and say, go and sin no more. Let every heart pray. Eternal Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We thank you for the beautiful souls that you brought to grace us today. I pray that you will give a word that will be uplifting to their spirit. I pray that you will give a word that will be renewed and refreshing to them. I pray that you will be in the midst of this service, and you will protect all those who traveled here and who leave. We pray that you will let your angels camp around them and their families. And we're asking you these praises in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, John 8, verse 1. I'm going to read 1 through 11, and it reads, but Jesus went to Mount Olives. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts where all the people gathered around him and sat down to teach. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now what do you say?" They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "Let every one of you who is without sin throw the first stone at her." Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left, with the woman still standing. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" Verse 11, "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go and sin no more." Very interesting story. As we read in the text, this woman was caught in adultery. Obviously, there was a male counterpart, but he was not held liable for his role by the men who caught him. The men who brought the woman to Jesus was quoting the law. And the law definitely said something about thou shalt not commit adultery. There was legal punishment for people who had committed adultery. And men's hearts really wasn't concerned with obeying the law. The Bible says they asked Jesus that question in order to trap him, so they could also accuse Jesus. So they wasn't only concerned about accusing the woman, they wanted to accuse Jesus too. Again, the question in reference to John chapter 8, verse 5, which states, "In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do they say?" What they're trying to say is, they're saying, "What do you say, Jesus?" You see, that was a very loaded question. Have you ever been asked a loaded question? Some loaded questions are hostile, inflammatory, emotionally charged, and can instigate trouble. Fortunately, belligerent questions are rarely asked unless a controversial topic or unpopular position is being advocated. How should we handle loaded questions? What would Jesus do? Well, Jesus was very strategic in the way he handled the matter. As the men waited for a response from Jesus, he bent down and started writing in the sand. In verse 7, they continued to question him. Jesus then straightened up and said to them, "Let any one of you who is without sin be first to throw the stone at her." Again, Jesus completely avoided the question. The men who heard Jesus' reply was moved with guilt and began to walk away one at a time. So essentially, Jesus never answered the question. If you understand history behind the question, you can understand how difficult it was for Jesus to answer. The reason was because under the law of Moses, if a woman committed adultery, the punishment was for both the man and the woman to be stoned. But at this time, Israel was under the Romans as a colony of Rome. The Romans prevented the Jews from carrying out the sentence. The Romans said, "Although your laws say, stone your men and women caught in adultery, we will not permit you to do that. So if you commit adultery and you were stoned, that would be a violation of Roman law." But the Jews felt that the woman had no power or authority. authority to subject them to their laws. So if Jesus says, stone her, he would be in violation of Roman laws. And on the other hand, if Jesus said, don't stone her, he would be in violation of the Jewish laws. This is what I meant when I said it was a heavy loaded question. Brothers and sisters, whatever way Jesus would have answered, he would have been accused of violating the Roman or the Jewish laws. Jesus recognized immediately that it was a trap question. Jesus chose not to answer the question that should tell you something. That when you are asked certain questions, you don't have to answer immediately. You need to give it some deep thought and decide if the question is even worth responding to or not. So you don't end up in the middle of a crisis. Sometimes we speak too soon and end up in regret because we can't take our words back. I'm going to repeat that. We can't take our words back. The power of life and death lies within the tongue. We are what we say. We frame our worlds with our tongue, be it good or be it bad. The choice is yours. I'm going to read James 3, 6 through 10. And it reads, and the tongue is a flame of fire. It is a whole world of wickedness, corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, for it is set by fire. It is set on fire by hell itself. I'm in the book. Verse 7. All kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, sea creatures are being tamed and have been tamed by mankind. Verse 8. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil full of deadly poison. Verse 9. With the tongue, we praise our Lord and Father, and with it, we curse human beings who have been made in God's likeness. Verse 10. Out of the same mouth come praises and cursings. My brothers and sisters, this simply should not be. Accusations were mere words that has broken up families and imprisoned people who were innocent and has destroyed nations in wars. Proverbs 15 verse 1 tells us, a soft answer turns away wrath, but harsh words stir up anger. It's not always what you say that can turn people away from you, but it's often the way you say it. Let's make a conscious effort to dedicate our hearts and tongue to the Lord daily. We face new circumstances, new conversations every day. If we make it a habit every morning while looking in the bathroom mirror to acknowledge our need for discernment of God's grace, will help us become more conscientious of our words. You can't just go around disrespecting people, lying and cussing people out, and thinking it's not going to come back to hurt you. Beware. It's often your very words that will come back to haunt and to hurt you. That can literally separate the haves from the have-nots. Moving on. Let's consider three things about the different postures that Jesus demonstrated while the men came to present him, the woman who was caught in adultery. When they came, Jesus was sitting. The Bible says he was seated and teaching. Normally when a person is seated, it speaks of a place of judgment. The person that speaks is ready to judge. And when they present the case to Jesus, he moved from his seat, and the Bible says he stooped down. Stooping is the place of a servant with humility. So Jesus moved from the judgment seat and into the role of a servant and started writing. After he wrote, he stood up again. Standing up is the place of a soldier or a defender. So Jesus moved from a judge to a servant to a defender. He encompassed all three roles. He said, "You came for me to judge this woman, but I'm going to serve her. And after I serve her, I will defend her. And any one of you who think you can come against this woman, I am serving you notice that I am standing by her, with her, and for her. And that goes to you too. No matter what you've been through, no matter what you're going through, God said he will stand by you, with you, and for you. Amen. Believe it." Amen. Jesus stooped to the ground and started writing. No one really knew what he wrote. There were speculations of what he might have written. In Jesus' response to this woman, we see him moving from a judge to an advocate, moving from a judge to a role of a lawyer. So instead of judging the woman, Jesus became her defense attorney. Is there anybody in here who needs a defense attorney? Just pray to God. Let him be your defense attorney.
Amen.
What Jesus was doing was very intentional. He was writing with his finger. The Bible tells us two things to know. The law of Moses was also written by the finger of God. Do you remember that in the book of Exodus? The law of Moses was written in stone. That means it was unchangeable. Under the law of Moses, there is condemnation when you sin. You have no recourse for freedom. Under the law, written by the finger of God, in stone, there was no remission of sins. But Jesus also wrote something with his finger. The same finger that wrote the law on the stone, this time it was written on sand. It is the law of grace. The law of grace says, God wrote, which was written in stone, sins of man written in stone is now written in sand. When it is written in sand, it means that it can be redeemed. When you sin against God, he don't write it in stone. He writes it in the sand. And he can wipe the slate clean. So you can start a new, fresh life. Is there anybody that wants a new, fresh life? Today is your day. God wants to help you. Let God bless you. Today, the same finger of Jesus that wrote on the sand is still writing on the sand today. God is saying, no matter what the accusations are against you, and no matter what sins you have committed, if you come to Jesus with your sins, he is able to wipe the slate clean. But he doesn't wipe it so that you can go and sin again. He wipes it clean so that you can go and sin no more. He doesn't redeem us from sin so that we can go sin again. He redeems us from sin so that we can live in his righteousness. You see, when you're caught in the act, you have no defense. The question is, what do you do when you catch people in the act? When we catch people in the act, when they sin, it's very easy for us to forget about our own sins. We become a little self-righteous then. Satan tries to make us arrogant and insensitive by turning us into accusers of our own brothers and sisters. The moment you catch someone in their sin, you forget about your own sin. That's how the men in the scriptures felt. They forgot about their own sin and turned into judges. Not sinners, not people with weaknesses. They turned into magistrates, people who administer the law. What I have noticed is most of the time, people who are very, very judgmental and speak with such anger with an evil spirit against something or someone, most of the time, they have that same problem that they themselves are accusing someone else of.
Amen.
The reason they are so angry is because they are guilty themselves. Accusers often become tools in the hands of the devil. I'm going to read one scripture in Revelation. It's going to be in the 12th book, the 10th verse. It says, "Then I heard a loud voice in heaven. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down." Satan is the accuser. It's not you. It's not your brother or your sister. Satan is the root. He is the accuser. And we must keep that in mind. Because he doesn't accuse by himself. He seeks to use agents. Unfortunately, sometimes we become his agent of accusation. But Satan is the ultimate accuser. Maybe there are people here today who may be under scrutiny of a horrible accusation. And you don't know what to do. Some may have been caught in the act of whatever. Feel free to fill in the blank. And you can't figure out a way. Some may have been shamed and can't free themselves. Others may have been disgraced and can't restore their dignity. But one way or another, a hurtful accusation has been aimed at you, true or false. The Bible says your sins will find you out. There are people who have been living double lives, who pray that their dirty little secret will never be exposed. Satan uses your mistakes, the bad things that you've done, to accuse you. Not only does he use our mistakes to accuse us, he uses our memories. Memories of negative past experiences. Memories of hurtful trials that we've been through. Memories of heartbreaks that's happened to us. Memories of things we couldn't get unhooked from. Memories. Satan wants them to go through your mind. He wants you to ruminate on those thoughts day and night, night and day. That's what Satan wants for us. And Satan keeps playing back to you until you find yourself in tears. The thing about accusations is it's designed to make you give up and throw in the towel. Warning, warning, it's just a trick of the enemy. Don't believe the hype. Don't fall for it. It's just a test. A person who feels there is no way out of adultery will continue to commit adultery. A person who feels there is no way out of using heroin, crack, or meth will continue to shoot it, snort it, and blow it. A person who feels there is no way out of stealing, will continue to steal. A person who feels there is no way out will continue to get drunk every day. A person who feels they have no way out and they can't stop smoking weed, they will continue to roll up blunts. A person who continues to fornicate and will continue to populate the earth will have a lifetime relationship with a friend of the court. I'm here to let you know, there is hope. There is always hope. As long as you have blood running through your veins, there is always hope. I don't care what you did. God don't care what you did. He sits right here, right now. He stands before you with his arms open, saying, welcome, saying, come to me. I love you. I watched you last night while you were sleeping. I know what happened when you were hurt. I'm here for you. I want you to come to me. I want you to draw nigh unto me. If you draw nigh unto me, I'm going to draw nigh unto you. God's calling you. He's calling someone. And I'm here to let you know there's always hope. So don't ever give up. Don't ever give up. God uses who he chooses to use, no matter what they did. He used different people in the scripture. David was a whoremonger, and he acquired a heart after God's own heart. And he is known as the friend of God. God don't have a respecter of person. Rahab was a harlot and is included in our Lord's genealogy and credited for hiding and protecting two spies for the Joshua mission. Abraham lied, and Abraham grew up in a pagan land. They didn't believe in our God, but God chose him to be the father of many nations and the father of faith. Paul persecuted the Christians and ended up writing most of the New Testament in the Holy Bible. Moses killed a man and stuttered, but God used him to split the Red Sea to deliver his people out of captivity. Don't tell me what my God won't do for us. We have too much proof. We can't walk around with our head hung down, singing a sad song. We all got bills to do. We all got normal circumstances to happen in life. But we can't give up. We got to keep on walking. We got to keep on marching. We are soldiers in the army of the Lord. Amen. It doesn't matter where you came from or what you did. God wants to use you. So stop sitting on your potential. God loves you unconditional, just like he loved the woman that was caught in adultery. Can you imagine the panic she felt when the group of men said, busted, caught in the act? Her husband, her children, and everyone in her circle learned of her scandal. Can you imagine how hard that was for her at that time? She was paraded throughout the village she lived in with torn clothes while they made a mockery of her. Try and imagine the shame and degradation she had to go through. But that's not even the end of her misery. She knew that she was going to be stoned to death. I believe she was trying to condition her mind to mentally prepare for the agony, the pain, and the horror she would have to endure until her death. She probably wondered, will the first stone crack my skull? Or will it hit me in my kneecap or in the face? Will I die quickly? Or will I have to suffer the pain of the impact of multiple stones hitting me until my evil, violent death occurs. Then I believe she began to wonder, after death, where would I go, heaven or hell? She was thinking, I've been caught in the act of adultery and sentenced to death, and now I have to stand before a just God, knowing that sin is what brought me here to this place, and believing that I have no mercy before God, who is angry at me because of my sin. She concluded that she was doomed to eternal damnation. My God. So the men brought her before Jesus. And she truly believed that she was guilty in the eyes of our God. But Jesus said, let any one of you who is without sin be the first to cast the first stone. And suddenly, the people who were going to stone her began to walk away one after the other. She still wasn't sure how the story was going to end until she heard the words from the mouth of Jesus saying to her, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. God bless you. Amen. Amen. I remember in 1980, my brother, Bishop Hugh Smith, he went to church with our mom at Bethlehem Temple. And he sat there. He didn't go to get saved or nothing. We talked about it. He was just going, you know, that would make mom happy. So the man started preaching. A man from Detroit started preaching. And he started preaching these words. How long will you be a slave to sin? How long will you be a slave to sin? Those words penetrated his heart. He started seeing himself, he said, as filthy. He never felt that way before. You know, when you recognize the sin, the weight of sin, and when you recognize that weight on you, you know that you need God. And my brother, he got out of his chair and he on his own and walked down the aisle and said, I want to be saved. And then he was filled with the Spirit and he stood up and he started walking around. Then he hit the pulpit three times and it was just like a miraculous experience that he had. But it's something I will never forget. And the question is, how long will you be a slave to sin? Is there anyone here that wants to let go of that weight of sin? I know it's hard. I know it hurts. I know the pain and the frustration. But God wants to free you. Free you from depression. Free you. Free you from those habits. And when you go home, I ask that before you go to bed at night to pray to God and ask God. He knows everything that you need. And ask him to give you that, to give you that assurance that he's with you. We know that he is based on the way he's been dealing with us. So I want you to fall on your face and just pray to God. Something you don't have to do openly. It can just be you and God. That's how I am when I'm in my prayer closet. It's just me and God. And that's what's kept me thus far. And I thank you guys for listening to me. And I thank you for visiting. visiting Kingdom Builders Worldwide. Continue to pray for our pastor, Bishop Tino Smith, in his absence. This is Sherelle Cotton. God bless you.
Your voice, your community.